Let's say you have an entire beach, vast beach, full of sand. Every single grain on that beach is counterfeit. It's not real, except for one, except for one. What are you gonna do? And you have to find that one that's real. What do you do? What do you do? That is the question. I was reading A Course in Miracles this morning, and everything in there rings true, and the exercises are great, and I say, you know, yeah, but the thing is, for 35 years plus, I've tried, nothing's ever worked. None of the exercises have ever worked. Nothing's ever worked at all for me. And I asked the Holy Spirit, I said, what works? What works? Can you tell me something that works so I don't have to keep on trying? Trying doesn't seem to work. And then I recalled in previous videos a while back, I had said that nothing works, nothing will ever work for me, sort of the negative affirmations. And paradoxically, that's what worked for me. That's what worked for me. And I bring you back to the beach with a grain of sand. And what do you do? What do you do? What do you do? You do. Pour all of the sand into a furnace, okay, a blazing furnace, all of it, without exception, and say, none of this is sand. It's all fake. It's all fake, so I consign it all to the furnace. Now, what's going to happen? What's going to happen is all the fake sand is going to be burnt, incinerated, and in the end, you open it up, and what's left, the one grain, the one real grain of sand is there. It's there. So this is how I see it. I see the best way, what actually works, is to assert that nothing works. Because ultimately, paradoxically, that's what works. Can you see that? To say there is no sand here that is real. Let's throw it all in. Well, you know that there's one real grain there. All right, but you can't get tricked into searching for it. So what I see that these lessons of Jesus are spot on, absolutely spot on, and yet for me they've never worked. I've never even had a hint of them working. So it's better to say nothing works, because somehow it's like a search for what works. Is this going to work? Is this going to work? Somehow there's something keeping it from working, and in order to save time, it's better to say nothing works. Absolutely nothing works. And paradoxically, that will work. So, we're back on track. I got knocked off track for a little while. Because this affirmation that nothing works terrifies the ego. Terrifies the ego. Now, keep in mind that everything that we think we are comes from the ego. That's the ego's belief in what we are. All our depression, our despair, our confusion, our suffering, our sickness, that is all the ego's opinion of us. It's not what we are at all. So you might say 100% of the ego's opinion of us is false. None of it works. So when we try these spiritual techniques, we're trying to change the ego's opinion of what we are, which is impossible. It's impossible. Therefore, it's better to say, none of the ego's opinion of what I am is true. None of it. Absolutely none of it. And none of the techniques I use to change the ego's opinion are ever going to work. That is a quicker, better way. Okay. The ego, again, is just completely freaked out by this approach. Completely freaked out. Because it knows it's finished. It's finished. And like I said, when I use this approach, I have had, you know, experiential breakthroughs rather than just conceptual struggling with the ego's opinion. So when you use like these techniques, any technique, you're really trying to change the ego's opinion of what you are. Even though the technique says the ego's opinion doesn't matter, you're still trying to get the ego to say that its technique, that its opinion doesn't matter, which is futile. So how to save all this time is to simply say nothing works. There's absolutely nothing that'll ever work. Which is true. Right? You can't change the ego's opinion. It's impossible. So paradoxically, when you say nothing ever will ever work, the ego begins to lose strength, loses grip on you. It maintains its grip on you by you doing all the spiritual striving. Because it'll say, oh, you really got me there. Whoa, you know, that's really profound. That's what I've experienced in the Course in Miracles, is I think I'm getting somewhere. I think, and the ego says, wow, you know, that's great, that's amazing. And so it kind of, you keep thinking that you're making progress. But no, the ego is still entirely in charge, actually. The way to make progress is to say, I'll never make any progress. And that is when the ego loses its grip on you. You want the ego to lose its grip on you, not grapple with it. Because the more you grapple with the ego, the more it grabs a hold of you. Even though your grappling might be with A Course in Miracles or the Bible or any other spiritual teaching. So I've been trying to find a way here in this world to save time for everyone, to save this, you know, this terrible grappling with the opinion the ego has of us. And so what I'm seeing works is that to say nothing will ever work. I can never make the slightest bit of progress. I'll never make the slightest bit of progress. Now, you might think that we'll get all depressed. No, because what happens is what is true about us that needs no technique remains. It's the ego that needs technique. It's the ego that needs marketing. It's the ego that needs to try to grab a hold of us. It's the ego that needs to try to convince us. We don't need to convince ourselves of what we are. It's the ego that's trying to convince us of what we are. We already are what we are. We already are abiding in the super matrix. Everything is. And the ego is trying to convince us that we're not, or we're partially there, or we're on our way there, or something. All this stuff on our way, evolving there. We're evolving into the super matrix. We're getting there. We're making spiritual progress. All of that is delusion. It's all delusion. So it's way better to say, I can never make any progress. Progress is impossible for me. Success is impossible for me. Nothing will ever work for me. That is what works. Because the ego's just, it has to let go. Because you're denying the ego right there. You're denying that anything needs to be done. You see, what we truly are is always has been what we are. We are abiding within creation, the true creation of God, everything. Even dreams abide in the super matrix of pure spaciousness. Even dreams of not abiding there abide there. There's nothing we have to do at all. There's absolutely nothing we have to do. We don't have to have any success at all. The whole notion of success, of succeeding, is delusion. And so if we can just turn that corner and start applying this, what I've experienced is I've experienced actual feeling of like, whoa, I'm being liberated. You know, I'm the fact that I've never been bound is dawning upon me. Now, the intermediate step that solves the continuity problem is that everything gives off an echo of truth. It echoes. It's like an echo. All concrete things echo, tinges of light around everything. It's an echo of the voice of God, as A Course in Miracles puts it. But how to actually realize this is to say, I'll never realize it. I, meaning the ego. But as long as we feel that there's something that has to happen, I have to do something, we are trapped. Because we are not this body, we are not this psyche. There's nothing in the world that reminds us of what we are at all. And so the whole context of spiritual effort is inherently problematical. So again, let's see if I can get back to this, what actually is going to be beneficial to us, is to say nothing will ever be beneficial to us. I'll never succeed. No efforts will ever benefit me. I have no benefits to... No benefits will ever come to me. I can never find what I'm looking for. I will never succeed. Nothing I do helps me at all. Etc., etc., etc. This is all talking about the I, which is the ego's opinion of us. So what you're really saying is, ego, you're useless to me. That's basically what we're saying. You're completely useless. I have no use for you whatsoever. Because this intermediate step of seeing tinges of light around everything, everything extending, Jesus calls the echo of the voice of God, echoing off of it, all concrete reifications, all things, all of this, gives us a sense of this, of reality, beautiful sense of spaciousness and expansion and extension of reality. So we let's just take that as a given. That's going to be there. And focus on the I. There's nothing that I can do. I will never be realized. There's another. I will never be realized. There again. Meaning the opinion that the ego has of us will never be true. But state it in a direct sense. Say, I will never be realized. I will never be free. There's no technique I can ever be used to be free. There's nothing that will ever help me. So me, I, all this is the ego's opinion of us. That is what we want to drop. Without dropping that, we're still doomed. You know, we're still just absolutely grappling with the ego, which is futility, absolute futility. So we can take A Course in Miracles and say, none of these exercises will ever work for me. It's impossible. It can never work for me. I can never be helped by any of these exercises. I can never be helped by any teacher. I can never be helped by any teaching. There's nothing that can ever help me. And the ego, this is like kryptonite to the ego. The ego say, I gotta stay away from this one. He's crazy, you know. And I gotta, oh wow, I'll go help somebody else. I'll go help someone else. Yeah. That is true. The ego will back away and say, wow, I can't help this one. See, I can never be helped. I can never be helped. I will never succeed. There's nothing that can ever help me. I will never be free. I will never be free. I will never be free. And there's no depression that sets in here at all for me. No. Or quote unquote me. There's no depression that's being felt. There's no place that will ever help me. No teacher will ever be able to help me. I'm completely beyond help. See that? I am completely beyond help. I is completely beyond helpfulness too, isn't it? It is completely beyond helpfulness. But I am completely beyond help. I will never be realized. I will never be enlightened. I will never be able to see. I will never be well. I will never escape suffering. There's nothing that anyone can do to help me. That's very true, right? Can the ego be helped to give the correct opinion of what we are? No. Because the ego is a denial of what we are. So how can a denial give the correct affirmation? It's impossible. The two cancel each other out. So you can say, I can never learn this course. There's nothing I can do that will ever help me learn this course. It's impossible. I can never be helped by any teacher. I can never be helped by any teaching. There's nothing that I can do to be saved. There's nothing that anyone can do to save me. There's nothing that I can learn, nothing that I can unlearn. I cannot be helped. And paradoxically, again, the great paradox is then you realize what it is that doesn't need any help. You see? It's not that difficult to get because what we are, truly are, doesn't need any help at all, except the continuity issue, which is a pragmatic issue, and that is there, but it's just pure pragmatism. We understand that one exception to all this, right? The one grain of sand that's real, the one exception to that is the pragmatic resolution of the continuity issue. But that is like also ultimately not needed by what we are ultimately, but it's a pragmatic step. So pour everything into the furnace. Say, no technique will ever help me. I'm burning them all. No lectures will help me. No videos will ever help me. Nothing's ever going to help me. No one will ever be helped in any way. There's no help for anyone in any way. And the ego just deflates the ego. It deflates the ego. And as the ego deflates, you begin to expand. You say, wow, expanding isn't so frightful. Automatically. So I can never succeed. I can never succeed. I will never succeed at what I'm aiming for. I will never reach my goal. I will never succeed at what I'm aiming for. And I will never amount to anything. I'll never be able to help anyone. See, all these cherished goals of the ego, these are egoic goals, actually. The ego says, yes, you're a body, but I can help you. Yes, you're a body, but you can help other bodies. Yes, you are this. In other words, its opinion is about you is true, and this is a great, you'll be very beneficial to others. Nonsense. You'll never benefit anybody. Never be happy. I will never have peace of mind. Peace of mind is impossible for me. Peace of mind is impossible for me. It is never an impossible. And again, from my experience, this is what actually enables an expansion and the clouds to lift. It's our attempt to accomplish something that binds us to the ego. But what is needs to be accomplished in truth? Nothing. Nothing. The idea of accomplishment is utterly foreign to reality. I will never accomplish anything. I will never amount to anything. All my time is simply wasted time. All my time is simply wasted time. I will never do anything with time except waste time. I will never do anything with this world except be bored and in despair. I will never be free of despair. I will never be free of despair. It's impossible for me to succeed at anything. And miraculously, you find that saying this doesn't cause much botheration at all. You kind of say, yeah. I will never get it. I will never get it. There's no way I will ever get it. I'll never get it. I'll never be able to get it. The ego's opinion of me will never be able to know what I really am. The ego will never know what we are. How can a denial of what we are know what we are? Cannot. How can whim be reality is the real question. How can whim be reality? It cannot be reality, can it? You can't have both whim and reality be real, because whim is utterly unstable. One moment it says this, next moment it denies it, contradicts it, does this, it's all over, it just, there's no stability at all. It's not reality at all. You can't have both whim and reality be real. It's impossible. So all we're, Because it's whim that tells us that it can liberate us, that it can free us, that it can enlighten us. That's all whim. That's all delusion. It's whim that tells us it can teach us something, that we can learn something, or even unlearn something. Even unlearning is also whim. Achieving anything is whim. Any achievement, that's just whim. Reality again, what we are, we're reality itself, in which there's no such thing as accomplishment in reality. No achievements. It's all the ego, that's all whim. So, whim is a ferociously deceptive dynamic, idea. And that's why nothing I've done has ever worked. And again, I don't see anything working for anybody else, actually. I see some people claiming to, yeah, they get it, but not really. Not really. That's still the play of whim. There's nothing to get. There's no one to get anything. I'll never get it. It's better to say, I will never get it. I've never gotten it. I don't have it now. I don't have it ever. I'll never get it. There's nothing to get, no one to get it. So I don't get it. I definitely don't get it. I'm nothing. There's no one. I am nothing. I'm absolutely nothing. I am absolutely nothing. The opinion of the ego, whim is absolutely nothing, because we are, again, so completely bound up in whim, we don't even realize it. The God that we're honoring and worshiping and obeying is whim, actually. And of course, whim will say it's God, and then it'll say it's not. It's, you know, just, yeah, whatever. Whimsy is whimsy, right? So whimsy will play the roles, oh yeah, I'm God, and yes, and then later, ah, no, I'm not, and I'm this. And then back again. It's like a butterfly just zigzagging all over the place. You never know where it's going to go. So, but we're so caught up in that, and we're so terrified of it, actually. Really, we're terrified of whim. It's a very, very frightening thing. Whim says, there's an abyss over there. Then it says, oh, no, it's not there. It's over here. Oh, it's over there. You know, there is no abyss. There is no abyss. So we have to take care of whim. Have to. At its root. Can't play its games. Cannot play its games. And that's what I've found my whole life. No matter what the spiritual aspiration is, whim is still in control. It's still in control. And it just plays us all for fools. Absolutely. What I've seen retrospectively is a massive amount of spiritual endeavor in the world with no success. Yeah. Very little. And we just might as well say no. Let's just say no success, because that's more accurate. Because there's no one to succeed. So there has been no success. There will never be any spiritual success, ever. There's another way to put it. The world will never be liberated. There will never be any spiritual success. No one will ever succeed. I will never succeed. You will never succeed. No one will ever succeed. And this is actually the greatest love. You give that out to the world, it comes back to you, and it dissolves the I, the me, the one that we think needs to succeed. Of course the I has to, there's a sense of needing to succeed attached to the I, and that's inherent, as its inherent nature, is the belief that I'm incomplete. I've got to succeed. I need some spiritual teaching. I'm incomplete. Now what we are is not incomplete. So any sense of incompleteness and a need to get enlightened is delusion. Nothing needs to be enlightened. I will never be enlightened. I will never succeed. Nobody will ever succeed. The world will never succeed. The universe will never succeed. There's no success whatsoever. Whatever take place. Only total failure. I am a total failure. You are a total failure. The world is a total failure. There's nothing but complete total failure. Ever. I and the world and everything. Now, again, reality doesn't need our affirmations to be real. See, these affirmations only burn up the ego. They don't touch reality at all. Reality is untouchable. So these negative affirmations don't bother reality in the slightest bit. So when you burn away what can burn away, the ego, the I, all that, what is left is reality, always shining, always there. So you gotta be very careful about positive affirmations that you're not boosting up the ego. Almost invariably you are. Now it's possible that some can use positive affirmations. Somehow they have some sort of affinity. Somehow that's something that works now. But there's also very possible that those using negative affirmations is maybe even more effective. Because again, positive affirmations can easily be bleed over to the ego saying, I'm getting a positive picture of myself. That's the ego. That's the ego. You know, all this stuff, this positivity is the ego. The ego says, hey, I'm making progress. I'm getting a better opinion of you or something. That's whim. See, whim can have a better opinion of you temporarily and then gone. See, that this is the problem I've seen is that people make success and then they fall back. They seem to go, oh yeah, I'm really, and then gone. What happened to it? See, it's whim. So whim can seem to improve only to veer off again. It's a butterfly. It's the elusive butterfly of whim. So I'm tired of this. I'm really. This is enough is enough. I'm not going to, you know, keep reading A Course in Miracles for another 35 years, or anything for that matter. So I asked, what technique can be used to free me from all techniques? And that is to say, no technique will ever work. Boom, right? Isn't that a technique that frees you from all techniques? And obviously, don't get into level confusion here and say, well, that's on the same level. No, it's not. A statement that no techniques will ever work is not on the same level of what it's referring to. Otherwise you just have level confusion, which is, you know, insanity. Because you can also say no technique will ever work, including this one. And then of course that's also a technique. And including that and that and that and that and that. And you go endlessly like that. There's no need to. That's level confusion, which we are very prone to, but just ignore it. Just keep saying it, just ignore that. No technique will ever work. There's no technique that'll ever work. And does this not free you up from techniques? And does that not free you up for simply recognizing what's already here? Without technique, that which needs no technique to be? So no technique will ever work. No technique will ever work. There's absolutely nothing I can do to succeed. Reality, see, reality is already present. The fact that we're all abiding in the supermatrix, everything is already true. You see that, and there's nothing more to see. The concern disappears. The concern will disappear. This inner doubt that we have will disappear. And to do that, say, I will never be free of my doubts. I will never get free of doubt. You can't say, I have the doubt, but I'm free of it. That makes it real. You're trying to then escape what you think is real, which is just makes things worse. So it's better to say, I will never get free of doubt. It's impossible for anyone to ever get free of doubt. And so the effort to get free of doubt is dropped. And then what is apparent. And in that, there is no doubt. So it's not like you have doubt and you get free of it. See, that is the ego's way. You say, I can never be free of doubt. I can never be free of troubles. I'll always be infested with doubt. Isn't the denial of truth, won't that always be infested with doubt? Absolutely. So I will never be free of doubt. I will always be infested with doubt. I will always be infested with fear. I will always be infested with sickness. I always will be infested with instability. Yeah, I will always be severely unstable. I will always be severely unstable. Paradoxically, by saying this, you feel like an effortless stability. That's just there. It's not my stability, you know, or your stability, or anything like that. It is total stability. It's the super matrix. It's God. So I will never be stable. I will always be severely unstable. I will always have mental confusion, mental disease, mental confusion, emotional turmoil. I'll always be confused. All statements about the I, which is accurate, factual. You cannot have an I and not have all these troubles. It's impossible. And since we have been identified with I to such an extent, it's tricked us into thinking that it's the hero. And we need to help the hero become stable. And that just, we waste our lives. Absolutely waste our lives on that. Never get it done. We'll never succeed. We never get the job done. We'll never get the job done. Never be successful. I will never succeed. I will always be unstable. I will always be fearful. I will always be deluded. I will always be deluded. There you go, powerful one. Now, in saying all this stuff, it's really not bothering me in this, bothering quote unquote me. There's no feeling of strain or stress or being bothered or anything like that. So, digging deeper, keep digging. There's no progress to be made. I will never make any progress. I will never go anywhere. I will never make any progress. I will never advance in any way. I will never experience any advancement. There you go. That's a strong one. I will never experience any advancement. I will never get out of hell. I will never get out of hell. I will never experience any advancement. So I'm feeling a little feeling here with that one. I will never experience any advancement. So what you need to do is to use these really affirmations of truth with never an impossible. And see your reactions. Keep doing it until you start getting some reactions. There's some reactions that arise. And then let them subside. You know, say, okay. Because it's been a while since I've used these affirmations. I don't know how long, probably maybe a couple month or two. I'm feeling way less reaction to it than before. There's almost none, but I got a little there with, I will never experience any advancement. Wow, that's got some teeth to it. I will never experience any advancement. Of course, the peace of God is the same everywhere. So how can there be any advancement? So I will never experience any advancement. Any advancement. I will never experience any gain. I will never gain anything. I will never experience any gain. Only loss. I will never experience any gain. I will never experience any advancement. I will never experience anything. I'll never get to experience anything. Wow, there's one that's got some teeth too. I will never experience anything. I will never be able to have any experience. Now I remember coming into this world, how I got deluded was, everybody said, hey, you can help us out. This is what we're all about, come on. Help us experience, help us be enlightened, help us, I help us, you know, I want you to help me, I want you. And so I said, wow, you know, okay. And then immediately you're caught up in delusion, immediately. It's hard to stay to the center, stay centered in, no. I will never experience anything. I'll never have any experience, is the truth about I. I cannot experience anything because experience is total. There's, everything is one in its abidance in the super matrix. That only from that context does any experience arise. You cannot deny reality and have any experience. So I can never have any experience. I will never have any experience. In other words, the will of I can never come upon any experience, no matter how much it wills it. It wills it. It can't will itself. Denial can't will itself to be true. So I will never have any experience. So this is all counter to the ego's intuition, but it's not counter to truth. All right, that's it. I will never be experienced. I will never be experienced. This one is loosening the roots a lot. It's kind of like you're pulling a plant out. You got to loosen all the roots. You're pulling the ego out. You have to loosen its roots. So you have to dig down into the roots. Pruning the tree doesn't work. That's like doing all these techniques. They don't work. It's just pruning the tree. The tree of the ego keeps growing. You prune it, it just splits off. And it splits off into more branches. You have to pull it out by the roots. So I will never be experienced. I will never be experienced. Wow, that's getting heavy. All this time we've spent trying to get experienced, right? Are you experienced? No. I will never be experienced. Just think of that. All these attempts in our life, isn't it an attempt to gain experience, to be experienced, say, yeah, I'm really experienced. The fact is we will never be experienced. I will never be experienced. And of course, do all these exercises in the mood of repentance. Absolutely, all important. Is you're not being cruel, there's no cruelty in you. You're being calm, dispassionate. Always do these exercises in a calm, dispassionate mood. Don't never enter into these exercises in a passionate mood. An energetic, emotional, you know, mood. What you're doing is you're dispassionate, very calm, saying, I will never be experienced. No mental reaction this way or that way. Just repentance. I have a severe problem, a continuity problem. This is how I deal with it. This is how it's dealt with. I will never be experienced. And of course, there's something within you that kind of aches over this. So you just let the ache be there. It's like an exercise. You're exercising and you feel your muscles, I got kind of a, you know, muscle a little painful there. I had a jumping rope this morning and I got sort of a little bit of pain in my hamstrings. Okay, you know, I really, that's what happens, so let it subside. Let it subside. Don't push it too hard, but just let it subside. Don't be all, you know, passionate, you know, and you know, ease off the caffeine intake for sure, because that makes you more passionate and intense, whereas you need to be dispassionate, very dispassionate. Not expecting any results. I don't expect any results. I'll never get any results. I'll never get any results. I'll never be experienced. I'll never get any results. And it's kind of like you're pulling I up from the roots, and this is like kind of traumatic for us, because this opinion of what we are, we've been following this opinion, this movie of the opinion of what we are for so long. Experienced. I will never get it. I will never succeed. I will never see what needs to be done. I will never be helpful. I will never be helpful. I will never experience anything. I will never gain experience. I will never gain wisdom. I will never gain experience. I'll never have anything to talk about. I'll never have anything to point to. I will never have any resume. Never amount to anything. I will never amount to anything. Of course, that never has to happen, right? Because everything already is in the supermatrix, is abiding in the supermatrix. Not partially, not conditionally. The supermatrix is unconditional. There's no place else for anything to go. The whole idea of like hell, like we're gonna be burned in the fire of hell and stuff, it really comes from the ego. That's the ego's opinion of, as we drop the ego's opinion of what we are, we see the tinges of light around everything, and we see the great rays of light, Jesus says, extending from everything eventually. And the ego interprets this as everything is on fire and being burned, which is not true. The light doesn't have heat to it. It's a spiritual light, not an energy-based light. So the ego thinks this is fire. And so the ego says, anybody who turns in this direction is going to be burned by fire forever in hell and be annihilated. It's really the ego that's being annihilated. In other words, the opinion, an opinion of what we are is being annihilated. But why do we need opinions of what we are? Only whim has opinions of what we are. So again, things are upside down. They say, oh, if you go this direction, you're going to be burned in hell forever. You're a terrible sinner. It's actually, when you drop the ego's opinion of what you are, then you begin to see light, and you begin to experience the utter stability of God and reality, the effortlessness of everything, of it all, the inherentness of it all, and you're free from concepts of heaven and hell, both. Realize there's no other place, there's only one place, which is everywhere. So this is not hell. You're not burning in hell forever. That's the ego's opinion. So the ego says, if you don't believe what I'm teaching you, and if you don't believe in death, and if you don't believe in a vengeful God, a cruel God, a God that would kill his only son, you know, demand sacrifice, if you don't believe all this stuff, you're going to burn in hell forever. That's the ego's opinion. And it's completely upside down and backwards. It's opposite. And yet nobody can burn in hell, because we're all abiding in the super matrix forever, always. There's no other place to be. There's no other place to be except everywhere. So what it means is that you're actually getting free of the ego's opinion, which of course the ego doesn't like. When you're getting free of the ego's opinion, the ego's gonna say, you're gonna burn in hell forever, you know. But when you're getting free of the ego's opinion of what we really are, what reality really is actually. It's not the opinion of what we are, it's the opinion of reality. When the ego says, I, you are I, it means reality has something which is apart from reality, which is not yet in reality, etc. It's a lie about reality. It's a whim about reality. That's what's going on. So when reality begins to dawn upon spirit here, begin to drop the opinion of the ego screams at you, you're going to burn in hell forever. Forever and ever you're going to burn in hell. Well, this forever and everness is your abidance in everywhere, right? Which is wonderful. And this burning in hell is the light that is emanated, the beautiful light that is everywhere. And the ego thinks that must be fire because I want you to be punished. You know, I want you to be punished. So it sees what it wants for you, which is eternal punishment. But that's not what's happening at all. That's its opinion. And its opinion is whim. And a desire for whim to be the new reality. So, bringing all this into the light, is it helpful? It doesn't help me, it doesn't help you, it doesn't help anyone, but it does cause the opinion of reality to, opinions, all opinions of reality to deflate away. It does bring that about. And then there will be no more opinions of reality, which means we will see reality as it is. At first, gradually and gently, with tinges of light everywhere, but around everything without exception, because everything is already abiding in the super matrix, not some more, not some less, not some greater. Is Jesus abiding in the super matrix to a greater extent than we are? Of course not. How can there be greater abidance in everywhere and lesser abidance in everywhere? It's impossible. It's ludicrous. Only whim could believe such a totally insane thing, you know? Reality doesn't require belief. Reality doesn't require any belief at all. Does everywhere require belief? For what? Those who believe they're in the everywhereness are, and those who don't are not? Is that make any sense at all? No, it's whimsical. The belief that we have with whim, whim tells us it's reason, it's not. It's crazy whimsical belief. There's no reason to it whatsoever, actually. It can pretend to be reasonable for a second or two, and then it flutters off, you know, like a butterfly. How can something be more in everywhereness and something else be less in it? How's that possible? Not possible. So, what do you need to judge? What's there to judge? Are you judging that something's more and something's less? No, there's no need for judgment at all. The final judgment is to realize that there's no need for any judgment at all. Everything is equally abiding in everywhereness. There's no other place to be. You can't be half in it and half out of it. You can't be partially in it and partially out of it. It's impossible. You can't be out of it at all. The ego wants to be out of it. See, that's the ego's opinion, is, oh yeah, you can be out of it. So some are in it. Like, yeah, Jesus is completely in it, but you, no, you're not yet completely in it. That's a statement that you can be out of it. Okay? It's not true. It's not true. Jesus is 100% in it. I'm 100% in it. You are 100% in it. Everything is 100% in it, because there's nowhere else to be. Even annihilation is 100% in it. Whatever we imagine annihilation, that's still 100% in it. There is no other place to be. Even the belief in non-being is 100% in it. There's no place else to be. So, yeah. So all we're doing is we're collapsing the ego's opinions, all opinions. Collapse all opinions. Doing this, I will never succeed. All this stuff collapses opinions. And we think, oh my God, I need an opinion. I need an opinion. No, you know. Is an opinion needed for us to be included in everywhere? Because that's our fear. Our fear is that somehow we're like one foot in everywhere and one foot in an abyss. You know, and like we're like, oh, I need to get away from the abyss. There is no abyss. How can there be an abyss in everywhere, everywhereness? There's only an opinion. There's only a belief. That's only a whim. That's only a desire to be greater than God, which is just a whim. So all our belief is based on whim. So we're collapsing whim, we're collapsing belief, we're collapsing opinion, all this stuff. We're deflating it. We're just deflating it. We're just letting the air out of the tires. That's all. Because as long as we're driving that car, trying to get somewhere, you know, I'm fleeing the abyss. I'm trying to find some place that's in reality, you know. As long as we're doing that, we're so deluded. Deflate all the tires, and then you can just sit there and say, wow, I'm already here. Everything's already here. Everything's already here. There's no need to find it, because everything's already here. Right now, everything's already here right now. But first we have to flatten those tires. I had a dream a while ago where we're driving in this direction into this extremely bad darkness. You have this, up on a hill, you have this backlit kind of palace and everything that seems like kind of interesting, but as you're going towards it, you're going deeper and deeper and deeper into darkness. And I said, whoa, stop. Flatten the tires of a car, you know. If we can't turn it around, flatten the tires. So you don't keep on going that way. So you got to flatten the tires at this point. And then that enables the oneness to be recognized, not through opinion, not through belief. You don't want a belief in oneness. You don't want an opinion of oneness. You don't want I to be enlightened. No, that's the worst thing. There's nothing worse than an enlightened eye. You don't want that, no. Saying it, I'll never be enlightened. I will never experience anything. Because the eye said, yeah, I'm enlightened. And then you say, okay, what are you seeing? What are you seeing? Right? And then that takes your attention off of what is already the case. You don't need to see anything. Everything is already apparent. The reality of everything is already apparent, completely apparent. Zero dimensionality to everything. In other words, there's not something more in everywhere and something less. So this whole dimensional thing. Now it's true there are different areas of decoration. There is a death-free realm, there's a fifth dimensional realm. There are different realms with different decoration. And those different decorations can be helpful. They can be helpful. Realizing nothing has to take place. That is true. But ultimately, the realization is zero dimensional. It's always been zero dimensional. It's just that we're not ready yet to completely accept that. So there is this so-called sort of a make-believe advancement take place from a pragmatic standpoint. Another thing is very important is waiting will never help me. I'll be waiting forever. Say that. I will be waiting forever. I do nothing but wait. My waiting will go on forever. Because what we're taught, what many are taught, for instance in the Christian tradition, is you can't be saved until Jesus comes back. So you're waiting for some external event to take place, you know. Nothing more ruinous than that is to be waiting for some event to take place externally. So I say nothing will ever take place. You can say Jesus will never come back, which I know sounds blasphemous, but we're doing it in the context of the I waiting. Now Jesus may return to this planet for the purpose of relocation or whatever. Yeah, that's possible. But again, that has no effect on what we're talking about. We're talking about opinions and belief, and collapsing, deflating opinions and belief. So the idea that you can't be, that quote-unquote salvation can never take place until some event in the future takes place, denies present reality, that everything is already, has always been included in the super matrix of pure spaciousness of God, in everywhereness. There's no place else for it to be, so it's true right now, it's always true. How could it need to wait? Why would you need to wait for this to be true? So you say the I will always be waiting, whether Jesus comes back or not, the I will still be waiting. He says, no, that's not it. I'm going to wait some more. I'm waiting. What else can I do but wait? What else can whim do but wait? Ultimately, right? All whim does is wait. And this is a heavy one. All I've been doing is just waiting. For nothing. Waiting for nothing to happen. Waiting for something to happen that will never happen. Waiting for someplace else other than everywhere. That'll never happen. I've just been waiting. I've been waiting in vain. I will always wait in vain. There you go. I will always wait in vain. I will do nothing except wait in vain. I will never do anything but wait for what never for will never for what will never happen. That's the I. I will never do anything but wait for what will never happen. I will always be empty. I will always be empty of satisfaction. And see, this is just letting the air out of the tires. So it's funny that I was reading A Course in Miracles, and I asked sort of the Holy Spirit, I said, hey, what actually works? I'm tired of not working. What actually works? Nothing will ever work. What needs to work? Is there some place, do we need to somehow succeed to get into everywhere? We've been out of everywhere, we left everywhere. Well, why? That's all opinion. That's all opinion. That's opinion of whim. What else can whim do but spin opinions and belief? None of it is true. None of it is true. And whim's great at spinning half-truths, isn't it? Yeah, I'm in it. Now, oops, I'm out of it now. I'm into it. Oh, no, I'm out of it. I'm enlightened now. Oh, no, I'm not enlightened. This is a game that whim plays that's all designed to make you think that there's someplace other than everywhere. That there's something other, some dimension to zero dimensionality, some quality to pure absence. It's all a game that whim is playing, and it's a very clever, whim is a very clever gamester, okay? So you've got to let the air out of its tires. That's what we're doing. I will never do anything but aimlessly wait, aimlessly wander. I'm just an aimless wanderer forever. There's another one. I'm just an aimless wanderer forever. Okay. So, you get the picture, you get the idea. That you'll never get the picture or the idea. But the meta message is there, right? The meta message is there. And don't let the seeming paradox throw you off at all. Because remember, we're dealing with whim, all right? If you understand that, you won't get caught up in this level confusion. Because whim will say, hey, is level confusion? No, it's whim that has level confusion. And the only way to free yourself is to deflate whim. You got to deflate whim. And therefore, you have to deflate the whole thing, right? Because it can seem to side with truth and then, you know, and then not side with it. It plays those games with your mind, and that's infinite delay. So you can say, well, I will always be infinitely delayed. I will always be infinitely delayed. So we're getting to some powerful ones here. I will always be infinitely delayed, waiting for what will never happen. I will always be infinitely delayed. I, meaning whim, okay? It's just another term for whim. But we're used to personalizing whim because that it tells us we need to. The idea that there's something that is not totally in everywhereness. You know, than I. Than I. He's got one foot in and one foot out. It's funny, I had a dream a couple nights ago where I suddenly looked up to the sky and I saw this big concrete form in the sky. And I'm trying to figure out, what was that? I said, it's a spaceship? What is that? Actually, it was in the figure of an I, like a Roman numeral or one or an I, the capitalized I. That's what it actually was. We have this concretized I in spaciousness that is over our heads. It's a mirage. We need to make it vanish, okay? We need to make that vanish so we see. Of course, but where is that I except in spaciousness? We could also look at it that way. But it seems so heavy, you know, it seems so dark and heavy. And it's like you tend to look at it and think, oh, you know, this is not in spaciousness. It gives this illusion kind of thing. So we're deflating this, deflating the I, deflating the I. I will always be infinitely delayed. And by looking up in the sky, I saw everybody else was just looking. They were under the shadow of this thing, under the weight of this thing. And I looked up and I saw. I said, look up and see this. Look up and see it. And I saw it there. Wow. This is the matrix that overshadows the whim that overshadows, you know. I will always be infinitely delayed. What I'm waiting for will never happen. I'm waiting infinitely. I will always be waiting. I will always be on an infinite wait. There you go. I will always be on an infinite wait. So this is really, you know, very, very auspicious for deflating opinion and belief. All opinion and all belief, including positive opinions and positive beliefs, you have to deflate it all. Because again, whim can play the game of positivity very well, but you're still entirely in its clutches. Entirely. And you see it, people can be very positive, you know, but they're still like butterflies, and no stability at all, none. And if you're depressed, you say, well, I will always be depressed. I will always be infinitely depressed. I will always be infinitely delayed. I will always be waiting, infinitely waiting. My waiting will always stretch on to infinity. My futility will always stretch on to infinity. Poof, deflates the whole thing, doesn't it? Paradoxically, right? Whim never takes you there, does it? You say, hey, I never thought of that. Well, whim never thought of that. Of course. Whim doesn't believe in endlessness, does it? But as long as we keep whim, it will extend endlessly. Its game playing will stand endlessly. It's an idea. Ideas never lose their effects. It's not like you have an idea and then after a billion years the effects stop. No, it's impossible. Where could they go? Someplace other than the super matrix of pure spaciousness? No, it's impossible. So we have to eventually let go of whim. Eventually let go of whim and all its opinions and all its beliefs. The whole thing of belief and opinion. Eventually, none, no more. But we're working on deflating it first, okay? Deflating it, deflating it, deflating it. All right. Now, as far as suicide goes, that's whim too. Whim says, whim tries to get you to kill yourself before you start deflating the tires of whim. You see, it's terrified of this deflation. Once you start deflating it, you say, oh, wow, I have power over whim. I mean, there's but there is power over whim. Whim can be deflated. And then you don't, you know, you say, there's some hope. You say, wow, whim can be deflated. I will always be infinitely stupid. I will always, my lack of experience will go on forever. You know, that deflates, very deflating, not depressing. Doesn't depress you at all. Opposite. It feels like you're coming out of a dream. Like awakening from a dream is what it feels like. It's when you're still trying to achieve under whim that you get super depressed. And as you start, as you tell whim, whim, I just can't do this. And whim says, well, you should die then. You should die then. You know, before you fall into the abyss, it's better for you to die than falling into the abyss. Obviously, you can't succeed. You're a loser. You're going to fall into the abyss. Turn the tables on whim and say positive. Positively make negative affirmations in a positive way. Hey, whim, I will never succeed. I will fail infinitely. I will fail infinitely. You be in charge instead of whim. You be in charge of whim and its results. And you state the results of whim openly. And watch whim crumble, shrink. Like a mirage, dissolve like a mirage. Hey, whim, your opinion of me will be infinite failure. All your opinions are infinitely irrelevant. I am infinitely irrelevant. I am infinitely irrelevant. And that's Wim's baby. He said, oh, what are you talking about? You know, my baby. You know, oh, infinitely. He's like, ah, you can't handle that. It just shrinks. Its opinion of us is its baby. You know. And of course, the opinion of whim is infinitely irrelevant, isn't it? The opinion of whim is infinitely irrelevant. I am infinitely irrelevant means the opinion of whim is infinitely irrelevant. But make sure you start out with I, because that is what we've been identifying with. Okay, that's what whim tells us to identify with. So don't let that slip by. Say, no, I am infinitely irrelevant. Whim is infinitely irrelevant. The opinions of whim are infinitely irrelevant. I am infinitely irrelevant. The opinions of whim are infinitely irrelevant. Whim is infinitely irrelevant. So, that's... It's good to be back with this. It's good to be back. It's good to be back. It's good to be back. All right. Very great. Let's end it up.